This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Burning World by Algis Budrys. Chapter 1. They walked past rows of abandoned offices in the last government office building in the world, two men who looked vastly different, but who had crucial similarities. Joseph Kimmonson had full lips trained to set in a tight, thin line, and live, intelligent eyes. He was tall and looked thin, though he was not. He was almost 60 years old, and his youth and childhood had been such that now his body was both old for its years and still a compact, tightly wound mechanism of bone and muscle fiber. Or had been, until an hour ago. Then it had failed him. And his one thought now was to keep Jem Bendix from finding out how close he was to death. Jem Bendix was a young man, about 28, with a broad, friendly grin and a spring to his step. His voice, when he spoke, was low and controlled. He was the man Joseph Kimmonson had chosen to replace him as president of the Freeman's League. The building itself was left over from the old regime. It was perhaps unfortunate, Kimmonson had often debated the question with himself, to risk the associations that clung to this building. But a building is only a building, and the dust of years chokes the past to death. It was better to work here than to build a new set of offices. It might seem a waste to leave a still new building, and that might tend to make people linger after their jobs had finished themselves. This pile of cracking bricks and peeled marble facings would be falling in a heap soon, and the small staff that still worked here couldn't help but be conscious of it. It was probably a very useful influence. They walked through the domed rotunda, with its columns, echoing alcoves, and the jag-topped pedestals where the old regime statues had been sledge-hammered away. The rotunda was gloomy, its skylight buried under rain-borne dust and drifted leaves from the trees on the mountainside. There was water, puddled on the rotten marble floor, under a place where the skylight's leading was gone. Kimmonson left the day's letters with the mail clerk, and he and Bendix walked out to the plaza, where his plane was parked. Around the plaza, the undergrowth was creeping closer every year, and vine runners were obscuring the hard precision of the concrete's edge. On all sides, the mountains towered up toward the pale sun, their steep flanks cloaked in snow and thick stands of bluish evergreen. There was a light breeze in the crystalline air, and a tang of fir sap. Kimmonson breathed in deeply. He loved these mountains. He had been born in the warm lowlands, where a man's blood did not stir so easily nor surge so strongly through his veins. Even the air here was freedom's air. As they climbed into his plane, he asked, "Did anything important come up in your work today, Jem?" Jem shrugged uncertainly. "I don't know. Nothing that's urgent at the moment. But it might develop into something. I meant to speak to you about it after dinner. Did Salmeji tell you one of our families was burned out up near the northwest border?" Kimmonson shook his head and pressed his lips together. "No, he didn't. I didn't have time to see him today. Perhaps he should have. But Salmeji was the inevitable misfit who somehow creeps into every administrative body. He was a small, fat, tense, shrilly argumentative man who fed on alarms like a sparrow. Somehow, through election after election, he had managed to be returned as land use advisor. Supposedly, his duties were restricted to helping the old agricultural districts convert to synthetic diets. But that limitation had never restrained his busybody nature. Consultations with him were full of sidetracks into politics, alarmisms, and piping declamations about things like the occasional family found burned out." Kimmonson despaired of ever making the old-fashioned politician types like Salmaji understand the new society. Kimmonson, too, could feel sorrow at the thought of homesteads razed, of people dead in the midst of what they had worked to build. It was hard, terribly hard, to think of, too easy to imagine each might be his own home. Too easy to come upon the charred embers and feel that a horrible thing had been done, without taking time to think that perhaps this family had abused its freedom. Sentiment was the easy thing. But logic reminded a man that some people were quarrelsome, that some people insisted on living their neighbors' lives, that some people were offensive. There were people with moral codes they clung to and lived by, people who worshipped in what they held to be the only orthodox way, people who clung to some idea, some rock on which their lives rested. Well and good. But if they tried to inflict these reforms on their neighbors, patience could only go so far, and the tolerance of fanaticism last just so long. Kimmonson sighed as he fumbled with his seatbelt buckle, closed the power contacts, and engaged the vanes. "We're haunted by the past, Jim," he said tiredly. "Salmaji can't keep himself from thinking like a supervisor. He can't learn that quarrels between families are the family's business." He nodded to himself. "It's a hard thing to learn sometimes. But if Salmaji doesn't, one of these days he may not come back from his hoppings around the area." "I wouldn't be worrying, Joe," Jem said with a nod of agreement. "But Salmaji tells me there's a fellow who wants to get a group of men together and take an army into the Northwest. This fellow, Ants Messerschmidt's his name, is saying these things are raids by the Northwesters." "Is he getting much support?" Kimmonson asked quickly. "I don't know. It doesn't seem likely. After all, the Northwesters are people just like us." Kimmonson frowned, and for one bad moment he was frightened. He remembered, in his youth, it was only 28 years ago, Bausch strutting before his cheering crowds, bellowing hysterically about the enemies surrounding them, the lurking armies of the people to the south, to the east, the northwest. Every compass point held enemies for Bausch. Against those enemies, there must be mighty armies raised. Against those enemies, there must be leadership, firm leadership, Bausch. "Armies," he burst out. "The day freemen organize to invade another area is the day they stop being freemen. They become soldiers, loyal to the army and their generals. They lose their identification with their homes and families. They become a separate class, an armed, organized class of military specialists no one family can stand against. And on that day, freedom dies for everybody. You understand me, don't you, Jem? You understand how dangerous talk like this Messerschmitt's can be?" Kimmonson knew Bendix did. But it was doubly important to be doubly assured just now. Bendix nodded, his quick, easy smile growing on his face. "I feel the same way, Joe." And Kimmonson, looking at him, saw that Jem meant it. He had watched Jem grow up, had worked with him for the past 10 years. They thought alike, their logic followed the same inevitable paths. Kimmonson couldn't remember one instance of their disagreeing on anything. The plane was high in the air. Below them, green forests filled the valleys, and the snow on the mountaintops was red with the light of sunset. On the east sides of the slopes, twilight cast its shadows. Kimmonson looked down at the plots of open ground, some still in crops, others light green with grass against the dark green of the trees. Off in the far west, the sun was half in the distant ocean, and the last slanting rays of direct light reflected from the snug roofs of houses nestled under trees. "Here is the world," Kimmonson thought. "Here is the world we saw in the times before we fought out our freedom. Here is the world Dubrovnik gave us, working in the cold of his cellar, looking like a maniac gnome, with his beard and his long hair, putting circuits together by candlelight, coughing blood and starving. Here is the world Anna and I saw together. That was a long time ago. I was 32.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.